Good evening and welcome to White House History Live. My name is Dr. Matthew Costello and I am Vice President of the David M. Rubenstein National Center for White House History and Senior Historian at the White House Historical Association. Before we begin this evening's program, I would like to briefly share more about who we are and what our organization does. The White House Historical Association is a nonprofit, nonpartisan organization with a mission to educate Americans about the history of the Executive Mansion, as well as the people who've lived and worked there. The association was founded in 1961 at the request of First Lady Jacqueline Kennedy and has worked with every administration since to preserve and protect the White House, its collection, and the history within its walls. We cannot carry out our mission without the generous support of our donors, members, followers, and viewers. On behalf of everyone at the association, thank you for your support. Tonight's program will explore the life and legacy of First Lady Lady Bird Johnson. You may only know or remember her efforts to beautify the country, but Lady Bird Johnson was so much more than a First Lady interested in pretty flowers. She was a wife, a mother, a grandmother, but also a businesswoman, a campaigner, a confidant, a leader in environmental conservation, and a philanthropist. In July 2021, the Lyndon B. Johnson Presidential Library and Museum opened a new exhibit entitled Beyond the Wildflowers, which features letters, photographs, clothing, and artifacts related to Mrs. Johnson's life. Joining us to discuss the exhibit is Lara Hall, curator for the LBJ Library. Welcome, Lara, to White House History Live.
Hi, thank you so much for having me.
Now, before we jump in, just a reminder to everyone watching on Facebook and YouTube, if you have any questions for Lara about Lady Bird Johnson, about the exhibit, please just type them in the comments section of the live feed, and we will try to answer as many questions as we can once we finish our discussion. So, Lara, let's begin with how this exhibit came about. Tell us more about the process and what went into the idea and the conceptualization of creating this exhibit to talk more about Lady Bird Johnson.
Yeah, so the exhibit came about, we closed our previous exhibit before this and our temporary exhibit space was about Motown. And as we were kind of closing that up and starting to think about what the next exhibit should be, we've been getting a lot of feedback from our visitors that Mrs. Johnson wasn't as present in the exhibits as she'd been in the past. We redid our core exhibits in 2012, and the 10th floor had been sort of dedicated to Mrs. Johnson and the work that she did both in the White House and after she left the White House. That changed to life in the White House that featured more of the first family. And so she kind of got a little bit lost, I think, in the story. And so one of the thoughts was that we would pull from our own collections as opposed to borrowing things from other people and try to tell some more of the story, just because it is something that is like, she is so much more than just like, let's plant some flowers, First Lady. So we really kind of wanted to delve into that, like who she was before she met Lyndon Johnson, and then, you know, who she was in his life, and then after they left the White House and after the president died, because she was still in public life after that for many years. So,
well, let's walk our audience through the exhibit, and you can highlight some of the key artifacts and stories along the way.
Okay, great. Well, here we have the first section of the exhibit, and it talks about the early life of Mrs. Johnson, starting with her family and growing up in East Texas. Lady Bird Johnson was born in Karnak, Texas on December 22, 1912. Karnak is a small farming town. And T.J. Taylor, Mrs. Johnson's father, was a huge part of the town. He owned two of the general stores in town, and then he also owned a lot of land that he rented out to tenant farmers. So her father stayed very busy with his business interests. And then she had two older brothers. They both spent time at boarding school and weren't around a lot for her childhood. Her mother passed away when she was five. And so Lady Bird was raised by her Aunt Effie, who took her on lots of outdoor adventures. And this is kind of where her love for the outdoors and the environment sort of starts. But despite all of this, she often would talk about her childhood as being a kind of a lonely time for her because she was the only little girl kind of in this town, and really just spent time with her Aunt Effie. She attended local schools until high school. And at this point, she and her Aunt Effie had to move to nearby towns in order to go to high school. So she lived in Jefferson, Texas, and in Marshall, Texas. And she was an excellent student. By the end of high school, she showed a great interest in journalism and writing. And she graduated high school third in her class where she was when she was 15 years old. After that, she went to the University of Alabama, but got really homesick for Texas. So she came back and enrolled at St. Mary's School for Girls in Dallas, which was a junior college. And then after graduating from there, she moved to Austin to enroll in the University of Texas in 1930. When she got to UT, her social life blossomed, and she forged friendships that would last throughout her life. In 1933, she earned a bachelor's degree in history and finished another degree in journalism in 1934. And she really talks about this time being really sort of defining for her. She said, "What did the university mean to me, a student from a very small town in Deep East Texas? It seemed then, and it still seems now, that all the doors of the world suddenly swung open. Here I discovered that college is only the beginning of learning and that one new horizon only opens the door to still another." And to me, this is an attitude that Mrs. Johnson, you kind of see echo throughout her life. So as soon as one chapter kind of ends, she definitely would swing that door open into the sort of next period of her life and continue to do so. Up until her death in 2007. So this slide shows what her calendar from 1932. She had a very busy social life. You can see kind of her handwriting and where she, what she was doing each day. The photos that are above that, the one is her at the age of 16. And the other photo is her and her friend, Jean Bollinger. Jean was the older sister of a classmate she'd had in Karnak, and she was also attending the University of Texas. She became a lifelong friend of Mrs. Johnson and kind of a bit of a role model. Later in 1934, Jean would introduce her to a young congressional aide named Lyndon Johnson in the fall of 1934. And then after a whirlwind courtship, the Johnsons married on November 17th. And it was truly a whirlwind. And a lot of what we feature about that are some of the letters and stuff that the Johnsons wrote back and forth to each other and that kind of short period that they were sort of dating. So
I was going to say that that's pretty impressive for a college student to have such a diligently prepared calendar. I'm not sure many college students would follow that. But she was very organized, right? She knew that these engagements were more than just being social, but this was a way to meet new people, new opportunities, and lo and behold, this is how she meets her future husband.
Definitely. And I think that, you know, I've read different like accounts of Mrs. Johnson during this period, and some people talk about her being kind of quiet and shy. But I think especially her friendship with Jean Bollinger probably kind of helped bring her out of her shell a little bit. And the calendar here definitely suggests that she was being more social. So.
All right, where to next? Oh, there we go.
Lady Bird Johnson and President and LBJ married in November of 1934. And then Mrs. Johnson stayed really busy throughout her marriage, both inside and outside of her family. During the 1930s and 40s, she became an indispensable part of her husband's campaigning for office. Managing households in both Austin and Washington, D.C. became something that Mrs. Johnson did for most of her married life. She played an active role in her husband's career and documented most of his campaigning. And then in 1941, and after LBJ joined the Navy, she took over his congressional office. And so she started sort of like running it and managing his staff and then writing to constituents and helping them address their concerns while LBJ was overseas. In 1943, Mrs. Johnson drew from her inheritance and purchased a struggling radio station here in Austin, KTBC, She turned the radio station around completely and helped it grow, eventually expanding into a television station in 1952. The station is still around here in Austin today and is one of the national affiliates. And she honestly, like, I've read accounts of her on the floor scrubbing the dirt up off the station, like being very involved in it. So the role she played both on the campaign trail and in her own business ventures highlighted Mrs. Johnson's interest in journalism. The camera pictured here is Mrs. Johnson's Bell and Howell camera from the 1950s. That's sort of that middle picture is the camera. And then the picture on the left is Mrs. Johnson carrying the camera around. She received her first camera as a gift from LBJ in 1940, and she actively filmed his campaigns, including their travels, campaign events, and LBJ's interactions with his constituents. While she was in the White House, the Navy Film Department helped her go back and narrate a lot of these films. And she talks about how much she enjoyed that. She commented to President Johnson, "Lyndon, this has been a marvelous experience. I wouldn't trade it for $1 million. Most important, I had the thrill of watching you grow under the stress in your ability to speak and in your ability to hold and sway a crowd." Mm-hmm. So she, something else she enjoyed doing was giving him tips on how he was doing as they kind of went through and did this. And I, like, these are so important. I think it's really illustrates how very aware that she and President Johnson were that his career was something that should be documented. And I think the sense started very early in LBJ's careers. Just this sort of like, there's something bigger growing here, and it's going to be something that we want to record. And I think her love of history and journalism kind of is really reflected in that.
Well, and I feel like I've read before, Laura, and correct me if this is wrong, that, you know, if Lady Bird is not there to not only help oversee these things, but also to help fund and to back her husband's campaigns, I mean, you may not even have a President Lyndon Johnson, because there's no senator, there's no congressman without Lady Bird's both, I think, political savvy, but also her financial support. Is that fair to say?
Yes, that is, I think, absolutely fair to say. And I think she definitely supported him financially. I don't know that he wouldn't have got the financial support from elsewhere if she hadn't stepped up, but she definitely was a driving force in his running for office and was a huge support for him.
All right, let's go to the next one. Ooh, excellent.
Yes. Well, I feel like we couldn't have a First Lady exhibit without a bunch of dresses. And so the team that put this together did not hold back on dresses. This is one of four ball gowns featured in the exhibit. But this one is dramatically placed at a turn in the exhibit space where it moves from Lady Bird Johnson's sort of early married life to a point where she becomes this experienced political wife. This particular dress was worn at President Kennedy's inaugural ball. And you can see the picture of Mrs. Johnson in the dress behind her there. Mm-hmm. Julia Zweig, I think, talks a lot in her book about Mrs. Johnson kind of becoming this voice of experience for Jackie Kennedy once it was announced that Kennedy and Johnson would be running mates. Mrs. Kennedy wrote to Lady Bird Johnson just after the assassination, thanking her for her friendship and offering her own advice on how to handle life in the White House. So I really like this dress because I think it really kind of reflects that sort of change that Mrs. Johnson makes kind of between the sort of like the Senate years and the VP years. Other images and objects in this room show what an active part Mrs. Johnson played in LBJ's VP years. He traveled extensively for President Kennedy, and Mrs. Johnson accompanied him. We have photos of their trips to India and Scandinavia, and we've also got a few gifts they received like during that time and on these trips. Oh, and this one. So this dress is actually one of the whistle stop dresses that the ladies for Lyndon wore. Mrs. Johnson took a very active role in campaigning for LBJ. the Johnsons were very close with their campaign staff, and several of the women who worked on the campaign would later go to work for the Johnsons. Colonel Juanita Roberts is an example of this. She started in LBJ's Senate campaign office, writing letters in Texas, and she would eventually become one of the key people in the White House as his secretary. We have several campaign dresses in the exhibit. There is a 1960 campaign Ladies for Lyndon dress. This would be one of the first dresses that the Ladies for Lyndon wore. It's a red and white striped dress, and the dresses were made by Stanley Marcus of Neiman Marcus fame. This particular dress is one of the dresses one of the dresses that the Ladies for Lyndon wore on the Whistle Stop tour. And then the Whistle Stop, of course, was Mrs. Johnson's sort of contribution to LBJ's presidential campaign in 1964. It was significant because it was the first time a first lady campaigned for her husband by herself. And according to Liz Carpenter, it was a woman-planned and woman-run operation. It was very organized. They would have guests ride along on the train between stops, allowing them to meet Mrs. Johnson, take a photo with her, and give her any gifts that they had for her, like baked goods or flowers. A lot of these goods, like the baked gifts and the flowers, were then distributed a little bit further down the line and were often sent to nursing homes, hospitals, or orphanages with a note from Lady Bird. So you would get on in town A, ride to town B, get off the train, and then at the next stop, town C, they would take the things that were given in town A and give them out to these various organizations. The trip itself was also a very brave move on Lady Bird's part. It was through the South in a time when Lyndon Johnson was not a popular person in the South. And so there were bomb threats that were made during the trip. The Secret Service would often get out and walk the track ahead of the train just to make sure that there was nothing coming up. The baked goods that Lady Bird was given, she often wasn't allowed to eat because of concerns of someone maybe trying to hurt her. So it was kind of a brave move, and then something that was pretty unexpected. At the same time, it was an incredibly sort of gracious, very Southern kind of thing that you would welcome women in. They had hostesses that worked along the way that there were these ladies for Lyndon, and they would take care of people while they were on the train with them.
Yeah, what's I always found this so fascinating was, and I think it was Liz Carpenter who also said that the further South Mrs. Johnson went, I think her accent just became more and more pronounced, right? I mean, it was about, you know, obviously, like you said, with the Civil Rights Act, Lyndon Johnson does not have many fans throughout the South, but having Mrs. Johnson come through and sort of appealing to them as a, you know, as a Southerner, I want you to understand my husband and where he's coming from, and sort of playing to that effect, right? That this is about like a shared sense of heritage. And it must have worked to some effect, right? Because didn't Lyndon Johnson, he did win some of the states. He didn't win all of them, but he did win some of the states.
He did. And, you know, Mrs. Johnson, her Aunt Effie that helped raise her was actually from Alabama. And so Mrs. Johnson spent quite a bit of time in Alabama growing up. And I think she did very much feel like a Southern lady. And like to her, this wasn't scary. This was going back to her people and appealing to them. And I think she really felt like she had a connection with people in the South, and that she can help it in the, you know, help him campaign there and help him be more understood. And it's interesting you talk about her accent, because one of the things I've really, really enjoyed about this exhibit is we have a lot of clips from the filming that she did with those cameras and her narration. So you not only, you know, get to go through and see the letters and the objects and things associated with Mrs. Johnson, but as you're walking through the exhibit, you kind of hear her narrating different parts of her life. And so you get that sort of very calming Mrs. Johnson voice coming through as you're walking through and learning about all of this. So it's really neat.
Yeah, I feel like I wish I could just run to Mrs. Johnson anytime I have a problem. Because I feel like she would just kind of calmly explain to me and walk me through the situation in the manner that she does with all these things, including, like you said, like even when she's like, you know, proofing Lyndon's speech. She's just delivering it, even though it may be a bad performance, she's delivering it in just a very calming manner. And she really kind of had that effect on him, didn't she?
She really did. You know, I've heard actually several biographers kind of characterize him as almost sort of manic. And I think that Mrs. Johnson really kind of calmed that tendency in him. And probably one of the few people he would take this sort of criticism from in any sort of like positive way. We've got a great audio of them talking on the phone after he'd done a press conference or a speech. And she was like, well, I'd give you a B plus. And I'm, you know, I'm like, I don't think anyone else could have given him a B plus except Mrs. Johnson. I don't think he would have accepted that. So
there's always room for improvement, Lyndon.
I know, right? This one. Starting just after the assassination of President Kennedy, Lady Bird Johnson started keeping a diary of her daily activities. Her staff would collect pieces from the day like schedules, menus, memos, and newspaper headlines. And Mrs. Johnson would then go through them and reflect on what happened into a tape recorder. A selection of these were later published as a White House diary, I believe in 1971. And in the intro, Lady Bird Johnson says, I began talking my White House diary into a tape recorder at our home, the Elms, 2 or 3 days after November 22nd, 1963. A great bulk of it was done in a small room in the southwest corner of the second floor of the White House, which became a combination dressing room and office for me. I recorded sitting on the sofa looking at the fire burning merrily in the little corner fireplace. And in the summer, I reversed one of the chairs and talked into my machine while I looked out over Andrew Jackson's magnolias to the Washington Monument. So you can see here the little sofa she's talking about. I guess this would be winter and she's facing her fireplace. As a former archivist, this is one of my favorite parts of the exhibit. One of the questions we used to get a lot in the archive was, how did LBJ feel about whatever? And it was so hard to say because LBJ never sat down and talked or wrote about his feelings. We rarely got, you know, sort of any kind of him writing down, like, here's what I think about Vietnam or here's what I think about this or that. We have telephone calls and photos and they give you a sense of it, but it's never really anything deep or reflective as the gems that are part of Mrs. Johnson's diary. And I, again, think this really illustrates that sense of history Mrs. Johnson had about her husband and her own interest in recording and writing about that.
Well, it's fascinating that she was recording and she was doing these. Lyndon buys her a camera. She's recording his performance. I mean, she's sort of a documentarian her entire life. So it's really interesting. Just a reminder to our audience, if you have any questions, please drop them into the feed. So we'll have plenty to answer in the Q&A. All right, Laura, let's go to the next set of objects.
All right. So as most people know, Mrs. Johnson rather famously championed beautification as First Lady. One of the big motifs we have in the library here are bill signing pens. We have a long row of pens as you walk into our exhibit space. And all of these are used to sort of highlight and show just how much legislation Lyndon Johnson passed as president. Above the pens, we have kind of just keywords for some of the legislation he passed. And so this idea of using the bill signing pens to represent the laws was actually started by President Johnson himself. So we have several pieces, much like the shadow box here, that pens are used to kind of highlight what was passed. I really like this one because the inscription on it, it says, to Lady Bird, who inspired me and millions of Americans to try to preserve our land and beauty, the land and beauty of our nation, with love from Lyndon. So these pens are used everywhere. And I just really like this one kind of spoke to me. And in the photo next to it, we've got Mrs. Johnson in the Redwood Forest. This was just after the Redwoods National Forest opened in November of 1968. And the quote on the photo is, "I've had a long love affair with the environment. It is my sustenance, my pleasure, and my joy." And I think you can really see that in this photo of Mrs. Johnson. Finally, on this last slide, this also speaks to Mrs. Johnson's love for the environment and to the legacy she wanted to leave behind, especially here in Texas. After LBJ's death in January of 1973, Mrs. Johnson remained in public life, and she actively worked on projects that reflected her love of the environment. The photo here is of Mrs. Johnson at what was then Town Lake. This was just one of many public improvement projects Mrs. Johnson spearheaded in Texas. Town Lake was created by a dam built in 1960, just south of downtown Austin. You can kind of see there, it looks much different today. And when they built it, it created this lake, and the lake was just kind of full of weeds, and there was nothing special or pretty about it. And Mrs. Johnson just didn't like the idea of that. So she had some trails put in and planted some flowers. Lady Bird Lake is what it's called now. And it's still a very popular place to go and kind of just get outside and sort of get that pleasure and joy that Mrs. Johnson herself got from being in the outdoors. This was called Town Lake until 2007. Mrs. Johnson did not want her name on it until after she passed away. So the city of Austin honored that, but on July 26, just a few short weeks after Mrs. Johnson's death, the Austin City Council voted to rename the lake in her honor. So now it is Lady Bird Lake. And then another local big project Mrs. Johnson led was the construction of the National Wildflower Research Center that's part of the University of Texas. It too has since been renamed the Lady Bird Johnson Wildflower Center. And it was one of Mrs. Johnson's passion projects in the post-White House years. It uses native plants to restore and create sustainable, beautiful landscapes and to educate visitors about the outside world. And I just really love this. There are so many outdoor spaces in Texas that wouldn't be here if Mrs. Johnson hadn't sort of interceded. And another one that's kind of not mentioned or seen here is Enchanted Rock, which is probably one of the most popular Texas state parks. And again, that land was saved because Mrs. Johnson interceded on its part. And then one of the closing panels in the exhibit reads, "Beloved throughout her life for her gracious spirit, respected for her tireless work ethic, and remembered warmly for her distinctive East Texas drawl, Lady Bird Johnson still looms large in the hearts and minds of people all over the world."
Well, thank you so much, Lara, for walking us through the exhibit. I just have a couple more questions.
Yeah.
Obviously, there's all kinds of great stuff in here, photographs, objects, letters. But one of the biggest challenges I would imagine with creating an exhibit like this is, you know, what to include in it. And obviously, you have to consider space, you have to consider themes, you have to consider, things like visitor overflow. And I mean, you're thinking about all these things when you create an exhibit. And so you have to be very careful and deliberate in the objects that you select to tell those stories. Were there any objects that didn't make it into the exhibit that maybe, like, if you could have one more in there, you wish you could have had it in there?
More dresses. No. I'm not sure. There were a lot of early letters and correspondence. And one of the tricky parts about putting exhibits together is sort of striking that balance between making it interesting and sort of making it a space that people can move in easily. And letters and things that have to be read don't always kind of make that cut just because they can take so long to read through, and different people approach exhibits in different ways. And a lot of, people might be intimidated, especially because these were all handwritten letters. Because of that, we kind of held back on some of the correspondence, but one of the things I really enjoy is that correspondence between her and President Johnson, especially during the courtship time. And then some of the correspondence with her family got left out. So you kind of, I think we have a good sort of reflection of what her relationship with her family was like, but I think you could really dig into it a little bit more if we'd been able to put more of the correspondence in there. I think the other area, sorry, that was missing was some of the VP years stuff. And we had some great things that they picked up in their travels. But other than that, we don't have a lot from that time period. So
how has the public responded to Beyond the Wildflowers?
Well, we have had a huge response. People seem to really like it, which is great. I've had visitors tell me that they would like to see it stay up permanently, which is a good thing to hear. And it's something that we are thinking about, kind of how to incorporate her more into our permanent exhibits. One of our exhibit designers says if Texas had a queen, it would definitely be Lady Bird. And I think that's kind of been the response that we've gotten from it. So I think people seem to be a bit surprised at how much she accomplished outside of being Mrs. Lyndon Johnson. And that is an interesting aspect to all of this. She's also got a lot of attention on Lady Bird lately. There's a documentary that's coming out or will be out soon. There've been a few books out on her in the last few years. So She's such a fascinating person who lives in such an interesting time to be a woman. I'm glad we've had the opportunity to kind of take a deeper look. And then some people ask where Lady Bird would be without LBJ, but we think the better question would be, where would LBJ have been without Lady Bird? So.
Well, and usually there's, you know, people are really only seeing just sort of a very high level view of these stories because it is an exhibit, right? I mean, you only have so much space for interpretation, for text. I imagine there's quite a bit of research that you and your colleagues had to do to dig deeper into these things. Was there a particular story or anecdote about Mrs. Johnson that really resonated with you and why?
That one's tricky. Anecdote that resonated. I think we got a lot of them in here. To me, it's that relationship between the two of them. There's actually two things that I think we kind of missed. And one of them was not on purpose, but Mrs. Johnson's Radcliffe speech is such an interesting speech because in it, she's almost telling these girls, it was done in 1964. And so she's almost telling these women in 1964 who are graduating college, like, you know, this is the time that like you get to be more than, you know, like this is the time to be like the role of women is changing and you can do more and be more like you can be anything you want to be. And I love that message. Unfortunately, it was written in 1964 and today it still sounds a little 1964-ish. And so we weren't sure kind of how it would come across, if people would get that this was sort of that permission to do and be everything, because she does kind of characterize it as like, you can be a mother or you can be this and not kind of both. But I think that if you look at her life, you can definitely see that she does everything, right? Like she was kind of all of these sort of pieces of womanhood that she calls out in that speech. The other thing that I wish we could have put in or probably addressed a little more up front would be the role that she plays in LBJ's life. Julia Swag talks about this memo that she wrote to LBJ in 1964. So he's asked her to come up with a pro and con list for running for president himself, like whether he should like run in 64 or not. And she comes out with a really great list and it is, she comes up with pros and cons and ultimately she's like, you will regret it forever if you go back to Texas and don't try to do this on your own. And so he decides to run for office in 64 on his own. And I think in part because of her words of wisdom that she gave, and they're incredibly insightful. So
Well, we have plenty of questions coming in from our audience, so why don't we turn to those? Let's see here. Rebecca from Facebook asks, how did she get her nickname?
She got her nickname from one of her nannies, and she supposedly said that Mrs. Johnson was as pretty as a ladybird, and the name sort of just stuck. One of the things we do kind of talk about a little bit in the exhibit is Mrs. Johnson may not have been as crazy about the nickname. And so when she was younger, she tried to get away from it. But then I think eventually she just kind of gave in and was like, this is who I am now. So
Tiffany from Facebook asks, were all the items in this exhibit part of the presidential archives, or were some donated by friends and family?
Oh, great question. So most of the items were pulled from the collections here at the LBJ Library. So they are things that are ours. There were two or three things that actually the Johnson family very graciously let us borrow to kind of help kind of bring a little more depth. We've got a watch that President Johnson gave to Mrs. Johnson and a nightgown on display. And then I think we have a suitcase and some books that belonged to her as well when she was very young. So they are always very gracious in agreeing to let us borrow things. And so we really appreciate it. But this exhibit actually was installed during the pandemic. And so it was really hard to get other objects from, like, normally we would borrow from other museums or other collections, but that wasn't happening because nobody was at work. So
right.
It worked out really well. And it was very nice of them to kind of help us fill in those little holes there. So.
Well, you mentioned during the presentation talking about Lyndon Johnson's feelings. This is a good question about feelings. Catherine from Facebook asks, how did Lady Bird's family feel about her marriage to Lyndon Johnson?
That is a great question. I think they were fairly supportive of it. She was actually staying with her Aunt Effie during most of the courtship. So the reason that we have these letters is because he was having to write to her in Alabama. And then her dad, like, they spent some time in East Texas, like right after his first campaign. And I think her dad helped finance, like, he was still alive when Lyndon Johnson first ran for Congress and helped finance part of that campaign himself. So they were fairly supportive. So I'm guessing they were pretty fond of him.
I was going to say they didn't stop the marriage. So
I don't know that they would have had much chance.
Yeah, but I think, you know, it is worth noting, because you pointed this out as well, that, you know, there is no Lyndon Johnson without Lady Bird. And that also meant in terms of, you know, emotional support, political support, but financial support as well. So it was a benefit to Lyndon, who grew up, I think, under different circumstances compared to Lady Bird. Julie from Facebook asks, can you talk more about what inspired Lady Bird's interest in the environment?
Yeah, so East Texas is very outdoorsy. The area she grew up in there are lots of trees and sort of wildlife and all of that. And then on top of that, her Aunt Effie was very much, I think, an influence there. She took Lady Bird on to Colorado. We've got pictures of her at some of the I think at the Kellogg, I don't know what they called it, the Kellogg sort of sanatorium that was sort of a health spa place. And then they would camp out and do things outdoors a lot. And so I think, like, just kind of that being outdoors was something that was very comforting to Mrs. Johnson. Mm-hmm. And so that sort of inspired her interest and love in the environment.
Hmm. Rebecca from Facebook asks, I think we kind of answered this. What was her cause as First Lady? Do you want to talk a little bit more about beautification?
Yeah, so her cause was, she definitely was the beautification First Lady. She took, like I said, was very interested in the environment. Some of what she really pushed for was this idea of making the world around you more beautiful. And that we could do that by focusing on sort of the natural environment. She worked on this in Washington, D.C. We have another temporary exhibit up right now that is about Dr. Seuss's The Lorax and sort of this shared environmentalism that Dr. Seuss and Mrs. Johnson had. In it, we've got photos of her planting flowers in inner city Washington, D.C. Because she wanted to make the city more attractive for the people who live there. So it kind of went sort of beyond this sort of large agenda that she pushed or encouraged President Johnson to push, and even like sort of focused on the local levels as well. So, she took down highway billboards. We've got a great cartoon in the exhibit of Mrs. Johnson, and it's like a billboard is a dragon, and Mrs. Johnson has got a shield and a wood sword in her hand, and she's taking on the billboards and sort of the stuff that was making rural life a little less pleasant. So,
yeah, and I think the other thing that people seem to forget is, in the 1960s, being for the environment, in the 1960s, this is more of a controversial thing, right? I mean, today I think it just kind of, everybody seems to be on board with, some basic environmental conservation practices, but in the 1960s is a very different time. And I believe this is part of the reason why they come up with beautification, right? I mean, it sounds, I guess, less threatening, but I want to be clear that Mrs. Johnson wasn't just talking about making things pretty, right? I mean, she was talking about major changes to improve the quality of life for people and communities, and it was around the country, rural, urban, you name it.
Right, definitely. And one of the things we look at in the Lorax exhibit is sort of why the 1960s. And so, you have Rachel Carson's Silent Spring come out, and Mrs. Johnson read it. We have a copy of it here at the library that was hers. She was very much a part of that. One of the other things we talk about in the exhibit is the Cuyahoga River in Ohio had been on fire like 7 times during the 20th century up through 1969. Mm-hmm. And sort of this need for larger protections to be in place to kind of keep these sorts of things from happening. And Mrs. Johnson was very much on board, and it did go much further than let's plant flowers and let's beautify things, and did kind of get into some of these root causes of why we needed to do these sorts of things. So
I like how you said root causes. That was a good one. we're going to combine a couple questions here. Some first ladies enjoyed cooking. Anna from Facebook asked, did Mrs. Johnson enjoy cooking, and did she have any favorite recipes?
Oh, great question. We don't address this in the exhibit at all, but I don't know that I would say Mrs. Johnson enjoyed the process of cooking. I don't know how much she actually cooked herself, but she did enjoy making menus, and she did have recipes. One of my favorites is she has a Pernalis chili recipe. And so one of the big debates here in Texas is whether or not chili should have beans in it.
Should have beans in it or not? Yep, absolutely. Yeah.
Mrs. Johnson's Pernalis chili does not have beans. So I'm going to have to say no beans in the chili.
Yeah, in fact, there was a chili bean controversy, wasn't there, over the recipe?
There was. And so they are not in there. But I will say that President Johnson did love beans. One of the things that I work pretty regularly with our education specialist here at the library, and she is always talking about this 4-minute phone conversation we have somewhere of President Johnson talking about beans and his love of beans. So
he's on the record, folks. He loves beans. This is from Luke. Can you speak more of Lady Bird's relationship with her daughters, and how did she balance family involvement with her husband's political career?
Honestly, I have no idea how she did it, but she did. If you hear either of her daughters talk about, actually either of their parents, it feels like it was a very close relationship. And she seems to have been very involved in different aspects of their life, even, you know, President Johnson was also very close. Both of the girls were married while he was in office, and remained close to him, like even after their married life. So it, from just looking at it from sort of this very academic perspective, I would definitely characterize it as a close relationship. And I'm not sure, again, how she managed to sort of balance all of that. But, you know, I've been looking at daily diaries for the president from 1968 recently, and he seems to spend, like, there's a lot of time spent with the whole family and with the girls, with the girls' husbands, the grandkids. LBJ doted on his grandkids. Mrs. Johnson stayed close to her grandkids for the rest of her life. And they're all still very involved here at the library as well. So I think it speaks a lot to sort of how close the family is.
Laura wants to know, what were Lady Bird's attitudes toward civil rights and her husband's Great Society programs?
I think she was incredibly supportive of him. That Radcliffe speech that I was talking about earlier was I think around the same time as the Great Society speech. And I believe she was out doing that to kind of help sort of support this idea of the Great Society. She, again, I think understood that sort of balance that needed to happen in the South, which is why she did the whistle stop tour. And it was to help sort of explain why civil rights were important and why her husband was taking that on. So.
Patricia from Facebook asks, will this ever be a traveling exhibit for those of us not living near Texas?
There has been some talk of this becoming a traveling exhibit. And it's definitely something we're open to.
I've already got the name, the Lady Bird Special.
Oh, that's great. I love it. it's definitely something we would love to share. She was such a special person. And we'd love to get it out there. So it's definitely something we would look into doing.
Excellent. Well, Laura, I think we were able to cover not only the exhibit, but all the questions. I want to thank you again so much for joining us for White House History Live tonight. I really enjoyed it. I know our audience did as well. But before we end the program, I'd just like to let everybody know that our next episode of White House History Live will be at 5:30 p.m. on Tuesday, May 30th. Our guest speaker that evening will be Dr. Elizabeth Rule, author of the new book, Indigenous DC, Native Peoples and the Nation's Capital. If you would like to watch any of our previous White House History Live episodes, please go to whitehousehistory.org and you can look up our previous episodes of White House History Live. Thank you for joining us, and we hope to see you next time on White House History Live.
Thank you.